Books on Tape presents H.M.S. Cockerel by Dewey Lambdin. Read by John Lee. Part 1. Quid faciat letas, segetes, quo sidere terram vertere, messinas, ulmisque ad jungere vites conveniat, quae cura boum, qui cultis habendo sit pecori, apibus quanta experientia pacis, hinc canere incipiam. What makes the crops joyous, beneath what star, Messinus, it is well to turn the soil, and wed vines to elms, what tending the kine need, what care the herd in breeding, what skill the thrifty bees, hence shall I begin my song. Virgil, Georgics, Book 1, verses 1 to 5. Chapter 1.
Oh, sir, watch out for the...
Wherever I go lately, Alan Lewrie mused, rather resignedly, I seem to be arse-deep in shit. Oh, well. He waved off the tow-headed young daisy-kicker at the old ploughman public house's hitching rail, who stood with silent offer to towel the offending matter from his glossy top-boots. No use, lad, Lewrie said as he swung up into the saddle. There's plenty more where I'm going.
Oh, aye, sir, so they be,
the lad chirped, letting go the reins he held. Lewrie dug halfpence from his wash-leather purse and flipped it to the daisy-kicker, who whooped with glee, as if the coin were the first he'd ever earned, as if Lewrie did not reward his chore each time he departed from the old ploughman.
Tie, your honour, sir,
the boy called as Lewrie turned his horse west on the high street.
Night, Squire Lewrie.
Lewrie touched the wide brim of his hat with a riding crop in reply as he clucked his tongue and kneed his mount to a brisk walk.
Squire,
Alan sighed with a snort. Not exactly true, was it? Squires were freeholders who rented land to others, while he was only a tenant, a rent-payer himself. Now if I sublet, he thought, perhaps to a well-off hermit, and was there such a creature as an eremite with the blunt, he wondered, who wished half an acre down by the creek where he could pile himself up a grotto and become Lewrie's tenant, performing perhaps the odd jeremiad, thrice on market days, talking in tongues or dancing like a dervish or old St. Vitus, would I then be a squire at last, or even less welcome in the parish? Might be worth doing at that. It'd drive Caroline's Uncle Phineas batty. His horse paced through the village of Angles Green, heading west for the vale between the rolling hills, hooves clopping on the icy earthen road, as candles and lanterns were lit in the windows of the homes alongside, and lights were extinguished as shopkeepers at last shut after long hours of sparse winter trade. Very few villagers were out now that the brief stint of cloud-occluded sun had all but gone, and the winds blew foul and cold. Without the casual labourers of the sowing or harvesting seasons, Angles Green was an even more tedious and emptier place than ever he had experienced, now Christmas and Epiphany were come and gone, and cold as parish poor's rate charity, and about as unattractive. Arse deep in it, he told himself again, glum with rum and ennui, up to my nose in acres of it, and that so bloody boresome. There were, to Alan's lights, much like the descending levels of hell in Dante's Inferno, distinct gradations to the shit existing in the world, and the quality and quantity of it a body had to abide. Uncle Phineas, his lessor, for instance, his eternal sneering stultifying monologues, his miserly few suppers or dues, which formed the bulk of a bleak, lurid social life, now there was shit from the lowest nether pit itself, and totally unabidable in quality and amount. In contrast, the literal item, such as the horse droppings he'd just stepped in, some of those he didn't mind half so much. Horses were noble beasts, beautiful in form and motion. Their stalings were abidable, for they bore convivial folk together, astride or by coach, eased a traveller's burden, pleased with their speed, heart and endurance, livened hunts, fairs, social occasions, or elated one with the order of their finish at a race. No, truth be told, Alan Lewrie, like all good English gentlemen, rather enjoyed horse poop. It had a redolence of hospitality, of congeniality, of freedom, excitement, and far horizons. The byproducts of the lesser beasts necessary to a farm, though, even his inept, clueless style of gentleman farming, of which folk said he did little but raise his hat, now they were odious in the extreme. He knew little after 4 years, and was forced to depend upon the knowledge of Governor Chiswick, his brother-in-law, or of the vile old Phineas Chiswick. They both dropped their jaws and whinnied at his questions, making him feel as out of place, even after 4 years of applying himself, as he had aboard Ariadne back in 80 on his first day as a callow midshipman. Or, even more discouraging, to have to talk things over with dearest Caroline in private, being coached on what orders to give that particular day to the few permanent farmhands or the hired day workers, to be such a humble know-nothing in his wife's eyes. Truth be told again, Alan Lewrie thought the life of the rural gentleman farmer stank in more ways than one, no matter it was the fondest wish of every successful man to make his pile, get acres, and aspire to the squirearchy. It was shit, of the most unabidable sort, and fast as he strove to shovel it away, here came more. His sheep, for instance. He squirmed on the cold saddle as he contemplated them. The farm, the rented farm, he reminded himself, was awash in the smelly things. Most of Surrey was, these days, unutterably stupid, messy, foolish, and shit-bedaubed. Even a goat could manage to keep a reasonably clean nether end, though they did stink like badgers. Swine. There's chapter and verse for you too, he thought. And chickens. Lord, what a fetid reek the henyard bore. It was a wonder a self-respecting fox would have a go at him without holding his nose. And cattle, I ask you, he grunted, his neck burning with revulsion. Fat, shambling, lanky-hipped, floppy beasts, capable of veritable broadsides of loose, flat, disordered ordure, shot off by the barrico whenever and wherever they wished. Stinky his city of London might be, brassy and corrupt a warship might become, but it was never a tenth as bad as a working farm. Sweet as hay and clover were in the spring, the garden's romantic aromas, soon as one inhaled a restoring lungful of bucolic bliss, here came some reek from some things best hung in the curing house as meat, revolting one, or plopped all over one's best pair of top boots. It was tempting to think that now his Granny Lewrie had passed to her great reward and had left him quite well off in her will, he and Caroline could move to London and use the farm as a spring and summer retreat, hire an estate agent to look after it for them. It did, in spite of his ignorance, turn a pretty penny or two, enough to qualify him as a voter. Then he could nod and smile on his rare visits, chortle over the books when they showed profit and call out, "Carry on!" to some experienced and knowledgeable underling, leaving him leisure time for horses, for amusements, for a real life. Lewrie hitched his heavy wool cloak closer about his neck as he rode near the Red Swan Inn. Late as it was, as close to supper time for the revellers inside, whom he could espy through the cheery diamond-paned windows, there was quite a merry crowd gathered there. A fair number of horses were hitched outside, blanketed against the cold, under the now bare but towering oaks. The richer patrons had theirs temporarily stabled in the warmer barn behind. He thought he spotted Governor's tall, grey gelding, and beside it two hunters he knew as belonging to Sir Romney Embleton, Baronet, and his whey-faced son, Harry. "Now there's shit for you," Lewrie thought with a rueful grin. For a mad fleeting moment he thought of going in the Red Swan for a stirrup cup of hot gin punch or a mug of mulled wine to warm his journey home. Just on a lark, to see the looks on their phizzes for daring to show his own in the more refined, high-gentry, squirish Red Swan. For just a moment, he envied his brother-in-law, Governor, too. He was married to Sir Romney's daughter Millicent, long before Lewrie had come to Angle's Green and wed Caroline, upsetting all the plans of 7 years before. Governor and Millicent could socialize when and where they might. Bad as blood was between Lewrie's and Embleton's, and because of them between Chiswick's and Embleton's, Governor had welcome still at Embleton Hall, and at all the parish and county's doings. Though it was sometimes a trifle thin, his and Caroline's, however, was non-existent, and looked fair to being non-existent far past the advent of the coming new century. Truth even further be told, since they'd returned from the Bahamas in 89 when his last ship Alacrity had paid off in Portsmouth, they'd been treated bad as leprous gypsies by those locals who walked in dread of Embleton disapproval or fawned on Embleton largesse. Considering Embleton influence over the area, it was a wonder the Lewries even had benefit of clergy.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.